There's an adventure in every cup waiting for you at Expedition Roasters. Expedition Roasters is the artisanal roaster of specialty Disney and pop culture themed coffees. So why not brew some magic at your home? Some of our coffees include Skipper's Brew, Ghoulish Delight, Enchanted Tiki Coconut, Redhead Rum, and many other unique roasts. Our coffees are certified gluten and allergen free and feature unique custom artwork by guest artists. So start your adventure today by visiting us online at expeditionroasters.com. And Disney Nerds podcast listeners, be sure to take advantage of this exclusive offer and save 20% on your first purchase with code DISNERD20. Brew your happy place. That's expeditionroasters.com.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
The Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the Magic Worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 259 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. On this week's show, we're going to take a look at the increasing prices of Walt Disney World. This past week, we just had an annual pass holder increase, and that caused us to kind of take a look back at some of the other price increases over the year, and then kind of go back and do one of those once a year things we all do as Disney nerds. Is it worth all the money we spend? With us tonight to kind of look through that whole philosophy of thinking, we have Jimmy. Hey, Jimmy, how's it going?
Hey, how's it going? I am fantastic. Thanks for having me on.
Oh, great to have you. Dude, it's been a whole week. We also have Lisa. Hey, Lisa, how's it going?
What's going on, Ed? How are you doing tonight?
Doing well. And we also have Sam. Hey, Sam.
Ed, I got my wallet out. When do we leave?
Yeah, I know, right? Well, that's the whole idea behind this show, is once we see these increases come about, you have to always kind of reach down and say, is it still worth it? I mean, I just scrimped by to make last year's trip. Now I have to actually kind of justify it more so. This past week, Jimmy and Lisa spent a little time in the live show going over this with a lot of our friends, and they came up with a lot of great ideas and answers, and we're going to examine that right now, too. But before we go any further, just to kind of let you know, the annual pass price increase was our second one of the season, and again, that's what made us start looking at this a little bit more closer. So the increase went from what to what?
It went from the annual pass increase went from $729 to $749, which was a 2.7% increase. That is for the Platinum Annual Pass.
Okay, and then another $20.
Yep, and then the Platinum Plus Annual Pass went up 2.4% from $829 to $849.
Okay. Now, earlier this year, they had a similar price increase. I think it was almost the same percentage. 2.5%, 2.something%, which kind of begs the question, why are these price increases happening so much faster? Also, keep in mind, this was the year we started paying to park at the resorts. Each car has a $15 per night payment that we do now when we stay at the Disney resorts, which of course is like the rest of the Orlando Strip, but it definitely is a different, it is an additional cost that we're thinking about this year too. And on top of that, the regular passes are increased every year too. So
I think at some of that is the comment I just made, which was another $20. But if it's another $20 twice a year or four times in 2 years, you know, we come to expect it, right?
Well, that is true. Excuse me. That is true. And you know what? Every year for the ticket prices, we do expect it. We kind of have an idea the weekend it's going to happen or the week. So we try to get our tickets purchased then if we need to buy those tickets or not the annual passes or whatever. But again, it seems to be that there's a lot of different prices coming up or different increases that are happening.
And I've seen it, and we've talked about this, but I've seen it mentioned in more than one place that a lot of it is, and maybe like not the annual increase, but the second increase, you know, I think they're trying to level out and curb attendance, especially in the busier times of the year. And they're doing that. They've effectively done that, and we've seen it. More and more people are going in times that we used to consider the off season. But I think the idea is that if the parks continue to get too crowded, it starts affecting the guest experience. So if they can make the same amount of money and have less people in the parks and those people have a better experience, it's a win-win.
True. And you're right. They have been doing that for the past 3 or 4 years, I guess, if you want to say controlling attendance. They have those prices that are more expensive at restaurants for the peak times of the year. They do now have prices for the parks for peak times of the year, which maybe deters more people from going during those really busy seasons. However, I got to point out, for a lot of us, there is no choice. I need to go over the summertime as far as the family goes, just because that's the way my job works.
True.
So it's tough to deal with the peaks. I mean, unfortunately, I have to eat that as another increase, too.
I think there's a lot of people in that boat.
And I do the same thing with my time off. My time off typically goes over the weekend. So usually I am down at Walt Disney World on a Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night. And I don't see those midweek decreases in the hotel rooms and the resort fees and all that other stuff that's going on down there. So I have that same experience, not to the extreme that you have it, Ed, but the way that my work goes, that's unfortunately the only time that I can get down there.
And, I mean, we're having a conversation about costs, and Lisa's right, because I was just down there over the Labor Day weekend, and some of the days I was there during the week, I got an annual pass rate at All-Star Movies in a preferred room that was less than $100 a night.
Right. That's incredible. You never hear that anymore. Actually, I get laughed at when I ask for prices like that. But, yes, they still are around.
Yep.
Especially that weekend. I think that's the only slow time still.
September, yeah. September's still, I think, fairly slow. It's hot as hell, but it's still fairly slow.
Sure.
Right.
So here's what I find fascinating about this time around, because we kind of got used to the annual price increase, and then they kind of threw in a twice-a-year thing. And Disney typically would get, you know, there'd obviously negative blogs about it and negativity around all prices are going up again, prices are going up again. What I find fascinating about this time is they've approached this completely different, and I think it sets them up for the future. And when I say that, it's this Disney Institute's flexible pricing and a new website and the ability to go and search and find out the best value for your dollar and when you should go to Walt Disney World, which is really Disney sort of evening the crowds out to some extent, outside of what you mentioned, Ed, which is when you can or can't do. But I think it sets them up to sort of tweak the prices as we move forward without having to do this, hey, we increased prices. What do you guys think?
It's very interesting you say that, because I have the site, the Disney site pulled up right now.
And it's just WaltDisneyWorld.com, right? That's where you are?
Yep, DisneyWorld.go.com. And I'm on the ticket thing, and it says calendar shows an average price per day rounded up to the next nearest dollar determined by your selected day of first use for a four-day ticket. And that's just because I have that selected. But then there's a link behind that and says see which months offer the lowest ticket price. And if you click on that, it'll tell you January 2019 has the lowest ticket price. And if you click that link, it'll take you directly to January 2019 to where you can find the cheapest ticket possible.
Interesting. How far into the future does it go? Can you tell?
I can click through and tell you.
I believe that, and you'll correct me if I'm wrong, it goes right up until we expect Galaxy's Edge to open. In other words, you can't buy a ticket today for after Galaxy's Edge opens sometime in the summer. So I don't think there's any prices in the August or September.
Incorrect.
What do you got?
You can buy tickets all the way through December 31st, all the way through 2019.
Then buy your tickets now, but we don't know when the exact opening day is going to be, because you know the price is going to change, which begs you to ask the question, does this end up being like an airline ticketing thing where they can change the prices based on what?
Happened, but it begs the real question is this, is that if you're determined to go see Galaxy's Edge this year,
you're going to pay it.
Well, and you're not worried about if I'm going to be there for the opening or not. Like if you say, you know what, I'm just going to go in 2019, might not be a bad idea to book your package now, because once it's booked, the ticket and prices don't affect you.
Sure. Makes sense. The
prices don't affect you. You know, it's locked in.
It's not a bad thought. So I tell you what, now, when they do that with the pricing changing and the days of the park and things like that, that still kind of throws a bigger wrench now into the whole process of debating on getting an annual pass or not. Because in the day, you would debate if it was a 10-day stay in the park over the course of a year, maybe an annual pass would do better and cost a couple extra less bucks. And it tended to work out. Now it's kind of a little bit different. We were doing some computations, and it seems like now, Jimmy, actually, go over. How did we do that?
I think the break-even point, and this is what we figured, if you're going to do a park hopper pass, you can do up to 10 days, which is the longest ticket you can do on a single visit. And it's still cheaper than an annual pass. But if you're going to do two trips within a 12-month period, 7 days is about the break-even point. So 4 days on one trip and 3 days on the next. If you're going to do more than that, you're better off getting the pass.
Jimmy, is a lot of that driven by the cost of the first day? Because the first day is always the most expensive. Then as you add them on, they get a little bit less expensive, yes?
That's right. So if you did 7 days in one trip, it's much less expensive than doing 7 days over two trips, because you're going back and paying for that first day again.
But then, Jimmy, how do you calculate the add-ons to an annual pass? How do you one of the biggest add-ons to an annual pass is Memory Maker.
Yeah,
Memory Maker. So that's $169 is what Memory Maker. And let me tell you, when people are going on a vacation, they call me to book a trip with the travel agency. I always recommend Memory Maker. And I know $169 is not just peanuts, but it doesn't take very many ride photos to make that worth it.
Oh, sure. Definitely. And when it comes free with the annual pass, that's a no-brainer too. Actually, let's throw on the free parking, because that always comes into my calculations when I'm going to decide on an annual pass or not. Because another one of the increases that Disney had just recently done, parking price. It went from $22, which is what it was in July, to $25 now for a single day for one car.
Yeah, we've just added $279 worth of value for a 5-day trip.
Well, and that's assuming you're staying off-site.
Or you're going to drive to a park.
Right. Because if you're staying on-site, you park free regardless of your annual pass. And a lot of people who stay on-site don't park at the parks at all.
Yep.
So that's assuming. Now, another perk of the annual pass, 20% off of merchandise. That's a huge one.
Sure.
And it's not just merchandise. If you buy a soft drink or a bottle of water at a retail location, it's 20% off. Now, if you buy it at a food cart, it's not 20% off. But if you buy it in a retail location, 20% off. And off a $5 bottle of water, that's $1 every time you buy a bottle of water.
Oh, right. No, that's totally. And that adds up like you wouldn't believe. So you're right. An annual pass isn't just the cut and dry difference between the daily passes. It is a lot of those extra things that you get for it.
Not to mention, I was just talking about, you know, that under $100 rate at All-Stars Movies and a preferred room I got over Labor Day weekend. That was an annual pass rate.
Sure.
You couldn't get that rate unless you're an annual pass holder.
And now if you have a little bit more of a different style than what a value resort would give you. I had the pleasure of staying at the Boardwalk on an annual pass rate in September, and I probably saved, Jimmy, you're my travel agent, I think that room was $240 a night.
And normally that room's probably $200 more than that.
It's a sweet place. Love it.
Oh, yeah. No doubt. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we're going to kind of do a comparison of what you actually get for a day in the parks. We've kind of talked about the different ways we can go with an annual pass or a single day pass. And a single day pass, which of course not many people really do. I think you're going to see people start at 3 days perhaps. But even at 3 days, it's still going to be $100 and something dollars a day. So what do you get for the $100 and something dollars? And again, another thing that kind of brought this up was I just went for a weekend to Minneapolis and went to the Mall of America, took a ride on Fly Over America. That's the Soarin' type ride they have there, which is really awesome. It cost $17, $18 to get onto it. So based on that $18, we're going to try to break down what a day at Disney World would cost. Now, before we even start, not every ride is going to be worth $18. So let's just get that across the plate right away.
I think some would be worth more.
I think some would be worth more. I think some would be worth a lot less. And basically, Jimmy and Lisa on the live show this week came up with that idea as far as trying to debate the prices based on the old ticket, the ticket denomination. So between the E-ticket being the awesome rides and the A-ticket being basically the walk-on or the Swiss Family Robinson-type rides, attractions.
They still have that thing?
Oh, sure. They just rehabbed that thing. It was closed in July, so I think it's going to be really nice.
We were hanging out there one night on a recent trip, and my wife and my daughter wanted to go up there, and they and Heidi went with them, and me and Frank's like, yeah, we're not walking up there. That's a lot.
I don't think I've ever walked it.
That's a lot of stairs.
Oh, if you've never walked it, you have to.
And, hey, I have done it.
And what's cool is they do change some things up. I mean, we always go on it for the hidden Mickey factor, and they always change things up like that. So it's always worth it once every couple of years.
I may have to go take a trip up there. It's been a long time.
I hear the views are gorgeous.
Well, and they've changed, too, because the foliage around the park just keeps on growing. So if you haven't been up there in 5 years, it's going to be a different view.
Interesting. All right, Lisa, put that on our list for next in a week and a half.
Done.
Yeah, have fun. Be at the cantina.
Kim and Caitlin and Heidi went on there, and me and Frank went in the sunglass store, and I was just taking pictures of Frank in different sunglasses. That's what we did with our talk.
Yep, there you go.
We try on ridiculous sunglasses.
My gosh.
So basically a day at the park, and you kind of go over this because you still, again, want to justify what you're paying, and I think it really does justify itself. But you have to do this every so often to keep yourself honest, I think.
I agree.
So are you talking an annual pass? Or are you talking versus a single day? Because one of the struggles that I have right now, if I'm buying a single day, Magic Kingdom, you know, sure, I'm in absolutely every time. Hollywood Studios right now for $120 a day? I don't know that I could justify that.
Well, if you're on a multi-day ticket and you have a park hopper and you're going to go there for a half a day and then get out,
then okay, yes. But you kind of see where I'm going, right?
Well, sure, I know, but it can't be that type of matchup then. What we're going to do is just kind of give an idea of what you get for your value going to the parks. Because I tell you what, even though Hollywood Studios might not have as many attractions as the Magic Kingdom does, it definitely has entertainment. It definitely has great fireworks show. It definitely
Fantasmic
has
and fireworks and Toy Story Land.
There's a lot of things, and it's a matter of like that's where I think we're kind of deduced down. And right away, we would say the entertainment. So you do pay the price to get into the park, and you're going to be going on the rides. That's part of your price. That's part of your admission. Now, based on Six Flags and those type of parks, what do you get on top of that? At Disney World, I think first and foremost, and we always say this because it always shows itself to us, we get service. We get the incredible cast members. So before we even get into the park, we've already seen that. We've already expected that, and we kind of hardly ever get disappointed, which I think is incredible. And if it ever happens to the point where there is a lack of customer service, usually Disney can make up for that more than enough once it's pointed out.
And just so you know, just to give you a fair comparison, and I looked this up for Dollywood the other day, which I think is, me and you had this conversation, Ed, is a little closer to Disney in the fact that it does offer some entertainment other than rides.
Right.
But Six Flags is the same thing, about the same as Dollywood. A one-day park ticket at the gate is $69.99.
Yeah, our Great Adventure is about 80 something, I think, in New
Jersey. Yeah, 85, I think.
Mm-hmm. So, and I know Dollywood definitely has some entertainment. We had some friends that went there last year. As far as the Disney World, so now if we're talking Magic Kingdom, we do have our parades, which we have multiple parades. And again, based on your kids' ages, how much they're going to be involved in that could be. And again, this is going to come up many, many times, but having my kid view the parade and get so involved, it becomes a priceless type of event. So you kind of put that in quotes as we continue on, because those type of things always present themselves.
Character influence.
Right. And you do have characters walking around most of the parks, but I don't think any of the parks have it as interactive as the Disney parks with the character books and the autographs and things like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, definitely. And what's cool about that is they kind of change up, which is very cool, and they interact really well.
I also think, and, you know, Epcot comes to mind mainly, but all the different shows, and you got the Jaminators, and you've got the guys that climb the chairs in France. You've got Voices of Liberty. You've got the mime in Italy. You got the drummers in Japan. You've got the acrobats in China.
Sure.
The mariachi band in Mexico. So all that entertainment is...
World Showcase is all about entertainment.
I mean, how do you put a price on that? You know what I'm saying?
Well, you can, because a entertainer like that, probably for a half hour, a juggler, you know, you'd pay $20 for a ticket to sit and be entertained.
And then, you know, Chris Hiller brought this up during our live show. What about the concerts at Epcot during... the summer series, Eat to the Beat, and then Flower and Garden. I mean, you get to see all kind of, you get to see Air Supply or 38 Special or Sugar Ray, or there's all these great acts that do three shows a day that's all included with your price of admission.
Mm-hmm. Very true. And they tend to be spreading that type of entertainment throughout the parks. Animal Kingdom, over the past 2 years now, has upped its entertainment value incredibly with all the roaming acts in Africa, in Asia. Also, Disney Springs, in the past 2 years itself, has also upped the entertainment factor as far as free entertainment goes.
It's amazing.
Of course, you're not paying to get into Disney Springs, but just even having it there is really, really cool. I think the last time we were there, you literally could not walk out of hearing distance of the next like band or live music.
It was a couple of trips ago, and me and Lisa were in the co-op. And we walked out, and right now, right outside the co-op is Dockside Margarita, and there's a pergola out there that you can sit under, and there's a guy just playing guitar and stuff, and we sat there and had a drink. Man, it was that's fantastic to go.
It was awesome.
You'd pay a cover charge to get that type of entertainment in most places.
Like Jelly Rolls, you will.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
There you go. But you're right. That type of entertainment is all over Disney Springs. Whether the last time I was at, we went over to the outside bar at Splitsville to watch a college football game, and there was two guys, just one playing drums, one playing guitar and singing. That was amazing. You got DJ Elliott. A lot of times is out by the food truck area. Right. They get people out there dancing and stuff.
Sure. Yep. Yeah, I don't know if Disney Springs is a fair comparison, though, because you're not paying to get in there, and that's attracting you in to have a drink and do whatever, that's versus an annual pass to get into a park, right?
Yeah, that's true.
But I'm with you. I love it.
I think you still consider that as part of the value of doing a Walt Disney World vacation.
Fair enough.
Right. We can think of the live entertainment that's also available at the parks too, in the form of attractions. We have the Flights of Wonder, or whatever the current name of that is, over at Animal Kingdom.
The Up Adventure.
Right, which is a very cool show. We have the Broadway-like shows at Animal Kingdom also, and The Lion King and Finding Nemo. I'm just thinking about that itself, and that would, you know, it's not a full-length Broadway show, each of them, but for what they offer, that's definitely a $20 ticket, if nothing else.
Yeah.
If not more, that those two shows combined are well over an hour and a half.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. So it's
you have some incredible Magic Kingdom castle shows all throughout the course of the year. They theme them for the season, and there are how many times a day?
As well as the Streetmosphere characters at Hollywood Studios and Magic Kingdom. You get the Dapper Dans, you've got the mayor, the firefighter, the all those people.
Right. Now, I think another thing that maybe gets overlooked sometimes too is the transportation. As far as you do have transportation really anywhere on property you'd like to go for free. Even if you're not really staying at a resort, that's not one of the main things they ever really check, I think, or I've seen being checked. So you really can get around.
Yeah, they don't check that. You can definitely go. You can use Disney transportation to go park to park. You can hop on the monorail or a bus. But when you said transportation, I was also thinking about how much does it cost? How much would it cost at, you know, just a random place to go ride the train like in Magic Kingdom?
It is a big price tag for that, that you basically get for free for going into the park and paying the admission. Now, as far as what I mentioned earlier, as far as the Flyover America and the Mall of America, that is the Soarin' ride, basically, give you an idea of it. And I've heard it mentioned that that's the Soarin' that should have come down to Walt Disney World, because it is soaring over America. You hit about 18 different locations, and it's, you know, just as smooth as Soarin' was, and the music's very awesome, and it was a really, really fun ride. It cost $18, and I would definitely compare it to Soarin' in that way. What other rides do you guys consider to be like an $18 or e-ticket ride, or even better? And I guess actually we could start at Magic Kingdom. What do you think, Jimmy?
I think at Magic Kingdom, I think Splash Mountain has a huge value on it, just because it encompasses a lot of. First of all, how long is Splash Mountain? 20 minutes?
Sure.
Yeah, it's 18, I think.
Yeah, so it's a dark ride. It's a thrill ride. So I think it's worth every bit as much as something like Soarin', maybe even a little more.
Okay, well, I tell you what. I mean, based on that, we could probably throw Space Mountain onto that as far as being that type of caliber ride. I don't think the other mountains are comparable. What do you guys think?
I think you have to also then argue that based on popularity, Seven Dwarfs Mine Train has to go on that list as well.
But we're not. I don't think it should be based on popularity as far as it is based on how much it took to put that ride together and how much they expected to get out of it. Well, maybe they did expect that on Seven Dwarfs.
So let me ask you this, Ed, and let's step back a second because you mentioned an e-ticket. I'm pretty sure everyone listening to this knows the story of the A, B, C, D, and E ticket. But what the heck is an e-ticket anyway?
So, and we had this come up on the live show because I threw up a poll and asked what people thought Thunder Mountain should be, an A or B or C, D or E ticket. And some people were answering A or B, and I'm like, man, it's got to be better than that. And then they commented that, wait, A is not the best. I'm like, no, look, I just took for granted because, you know, we do this show and we go often and we just understand a lot of the history. And I took for granted that people understood what A through E was. So the A through E is, you know, back in the day, you didn't pay admission to get in the park. To get in the park was free, and you bought a ticket book, and you got to exchange that ticket for an attraction listed on that ticket. And the A ticket would be something like Swiss Family Robinson Treehouse.
I think the Dumbos were an A ticket, right?
Yeah, Dumbo or, you know, a spinner ride.
The,
and then
the Delta ride was an A ticket, too. I totally remember that. But go ahead, I'm sorry.
I think the monorail was an A ticket, wasn't it?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure if that was
not at Disney World. At Disneyland, it may.
Disneyland, right. Yes.
It was the train.
Disneyland, it was an attraction. In fact, if you go back to Disneyland opened in 55, you know, around the 1960 time frame, this is interesting here, right? An A ticket was worth 10 cents. A B ticket, 15, mm-hmm. A C, 25, a D, 50 cents, and an E ticket, 85 cents.
So quite a bit more than a...
So if you put that, you know, kind of round up, it's kind of like an A ticket's a dollar, and an E ticket's $8.50 with everything in between it. That's
eight times more.
And you would spend $10 or $20 or whatever the denomination was to get a book of tickets, which would only have maybe two E tickets, yet it would have four A's and maybe three B's and, you know, a bunch of the other lesser rides. So by the time you got to the end of the book, you're always trying to trade off those like A tickets to get an E ticket from like your brother or sister or something.
Right.
An E ticket was considered to be the newest, most advanced, and most popular rides or attractions.
Absolutely. And that's why you still hear it today when people say, oh, they're building an e-ticket. In fact, you probably heard it when they announced the Guardians coaster. Oh, a new e-ticket attraction coming to Epcot. That's what they're talking about.
Sure. Yep, absolutely. Sure.
So anyway, let's go park by park real quick. Give me your e-ticket attractions at Epcot.
I think Epcot's easy because they're the Tier A Fast Pass attractions.
Right, right. Soarin' and Test Track.
Soarin' Test Track. You can lump in Frozen and maybe Fantasmic. Or not Fantasmic, I'm sorry, Illuminations. If you
Illuminations, yeah.
I'd almost argue that Test Track should slowly be dropped to a D ticket, but that's okay.
I don't disagree with you, other than the wait times for that's always ridiculous.
Sure, yeah. But then they'll also change it up, because once Guardians does open up, that's going to make one other ride kind of bump down.
And maybe then, I think you got a point then, Lisa. Because right now, my youngest loves Test Track. He'd do Test Track every time, but I think once Guardians open, that changes.
Sure. Oh, no Absolutely. Doubt. Okay, how about Hollywood Studios? And I know, obviously, the e-tickets are going to be when Star Wars opens, but what else do we got?
Well, I don't think you can use the same premise that Sam used for Epcot.
On no, I don't either.
Studios, no.
Because either. Since Toy Story Land opened, they've dropped Tower of Terror and Rock and Roller Coaster in the second tier, but they're still definitely e-ticket attractions. Correct. So you have those two.
And Slink Land, Dog.
And Slink Dog is a C or D. It's definitely not an E.
You don't think it's an E?
No.
I don't think it's an E.
All right, give it a D then.
I would say judge that e-ticket ride or whatever it's going to be by 2 years from now. Not brand new, yes. It's an e-ticket based on Lisa's description. It's new rides, this and that. However, it's the lasting value. And in 2 years, no, that's going to be another ride. That's going to be in the way to get to Star Wars.
Toy Story Mania e-ticket?
No, not anymore either. I definitely don't think so.
That's a great question.
That is a good question. D or E?
See, that's the same thing with Peter Pan. Is Peter Pan an E or like a C? Because Peter Pan, it's got the line all the time, and it's always crowded, but it is not that exciting a ride.
I don't think you compare Toy Story Midway Mania to Peter Pan.
But it's going to be the same idea as far as the way the park is. How many E's are you going to have? And you're right. You've already got the two, definitely, Roller Coaster and Tower, and then with Star Wars coming in, and... yeah. Anyway.
Yep.
So, and then Animal Kingdom, obviously Flight of Passage.
It's an F ticket.
Yeah, I know, right? If there, well, if the there safari has to be would one. Be-